out by now through the prayer, we're going to look at David and Goliath, right? A familiar story to us all. And I think in the bulletin I put 32 to 49, but I'm going to make it a little longer, so bear with me, folks. But I think we need to be reminded of the whole story of David and Goliath. So I'm going to go for 51 verses, so like I said, bear with me, it's the longer one, okay? But I hope that you'll hear the reading of this story and get the imagery. So really, if you need to close your eyes, I won't think you're sleeping. If you, whatever you need to do, right? Maybe you will be sleeping. But whatever you need to do to get comfortable and imagine the fullness of the words of the scripture. So now the Philistines, gathered their forces for war and assembled. They pitched camp. Saul and the Israelites assembled and camped and drew up their battle line to meet the Philistines. The Philistines occupied one hill and the Israelites another. And the valley was between them. A champion named Goliath, who was from Gath, came out of the Philistine camp. His height was 6 cubits and a span. He had a bronze helmet on his head, and he wore a coat of scale armor of bronze, weighing 5,000 shekels. And on his leg, he wore bronze greaves, and bronze javelin was slung over his back. His spear shaft was like a weaver's rod, and its iron point weighed 600 shekels. His shield bearer went ahead of him. Goliath stood and shouted to the ranks of Israel, "Why do you come out and line up for battle? Am I not a Philistine? And are you not the servants of Saul?" You guys remember who Saul is? Maureen spoke of him last week. He's the king, right? "Choose a man and have him come down here to me. If he is able to fight and kill me, we will become your subjects. But if I overcome him and kill him, you will become our subjects and serve us." And the Philistine said, "This day I defy the armies of Israel. Give me a man and let us fight each other." On hearing this, the Philistine's words, Saul and all of the Israelites were dismayed and they were terrified. Now David, the son of Jesse, who was from Bethlehem from Judea, Jesse had 8 sons in Saul's time. And he was very old. Jesse's 3 oldest sons had followed Saul into battle, into war. The 3 oldest followed Saul, but David, the youngest, right, went back and forth between Saul to attending to his father's sheep in the hillside of Bethlehem. For 40 days, 40 days. The Philistines came forward every morning and every evening, and he took his stand. Now Jesse said to his son David, "Roast grain and take these 10 loaves of bread to your brothers and hurry to their camp. Take along 10 cheeses to the commander of their unit. See how your brothers are doing and bring back some assurance from them. They are with Saul and all the men of Israel, fighting against the Philistines." Early in the morning, David left the flock that he was caring for in the care of another shepherd. He loaded up and he set out as Jesse, his father, commanded him to do. He reaches camp as the army was going out to its battle positions, shouting the war cry. Israel and Philistines were drawing up their lines and they were facing each other. David left his things with the keeper of supplies, ran to the battle lines, and asked his talking to them, Goliath, the Philistine champion, stepped out in the lines and shouted his usual defense. And David heard it. Whenever the Israelites saw this man, they all fled in fear. Now the Israelites have been saying, "Do you see how this man keeps coming out? He keeps coming out to defy Israel. The king will give great wealth to the man who kills him. He will also give him his daughter in marriage and will exempt him, his family, from taxes in Israel." David asked the man to stand near him. "What will be done for this man who kills the Philistine and removes the disgrace from Israel? Who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God?" They repeated to him what they had been saying and told him, "This is what will be done for the man who kills him." When David's older brother heard him speaking with the men, he burned with anger. "Why have you come down here? And with whom did you leave those few sheep in the wilderness? I know how conceited you are and how wicked your heart is. You came down only to watch the battle. Now, what have I done?" said David. "Can't I even speak?" He then turned away to someone else and brought up the same matter, and the men answered him. What David said was overheard and reported to Saul, and Saul sent for him. David says to Saul, the king, "Let no one lose heart on account of this Philistine. Your servant will go and fight him." Saul replied, "You are not able to go out against the Philistine and fight him. You are only a young man, and he has been a warrior since youth." But David said to Saul, "Your servant has been keeping his father's sheep. When a lion or a bear came and carried off sheep from the flock, I went after it. I struck it and rescued the sheep from its mouth. When it turned on me, I seized it by its hair, struck it, and killed it. Your servant has killed both lion and bear. This uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them because he has defied the armies of the living God. The Lord who rescued me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear will rescue me from the hand of the Philistine." Saul said to David, "Go, and the Lord be with you." Then Saul dressed David in his own tunic. He put the coat of armor on him and a bronze helmet on his head. David fastened on a sword over the tunic and tried walking around, but he could not use them. "I can't go in these," he says to Saul, "because I am not used to them." So he took them off. He put his staff in his hand and he chose 5 smooth stones from the stream. He put them in a pouch in his shepherd's bag and with his sling in his hand approaches the Philistine. Meanwhile, the Philistine with his shield barrier in front of him kept coming closer and closer to David. He looked at David over and saw that he was little more than a boy. Glowing with health and handsome, he said he despised him. He said to David, "Am I a dog that you come at me with sticks?" And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. "Come here," he said, "and I'll give your flesh to the birds and the wild." David said to the Philistines, "You come against me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This day, the Lord will deliver you into my hands, and I will strike you down and cut off your head. This very day I will give you the carcass of the Philistine army to the birds and the wild animals, and the whole world will know that there is a God in Israel. And all those gathered here will know that it is not by sword or spear that the Lord saves. For the battle is the Lord's, and he will give all of you into your hands. As the Philistine moved closer to attack him, David ran quickly toward the battle line to meet him. Reaching into his bag, taking out a stone, he slung it and struck the Philistine on the forehead. The stone sank into his forehead, and he fell face down to the ground. So David triumphed over the Philistine with a sling and a stone. Without a sword in his hand, he struck him down. May this reading be blessed by God for not only our reading, but our hearing and our understanding. Thanks. Understand again how this story impacts our life and invites us into discipleship in this time, in this day, in this place. So speak now, Lord, for we are listening. Amen. So recently I read an interesting article about a man who dealt with the Goliaths of his life. He was young. He was born June 28, 1971. And he was born in South Africa. And he was the first of three children in his family. When his parents divorced in 1980, so 9 years later, he decided to live with his father. His father was violent, and he would often lecture his children for hours at a time. He was an introvert, and he was troubled. And he troubled his parents. So he attended a special high school, where he often experienced bullying by other students. On one occasion, he was so severely bullied that he was beaten and admitted to a hospital. It was a very dark period of time, as you can imagine. One thing that helped him endure his childhood was technology. In 1983, at the age of 12, he created a simple game called Blastar. Maybe you've heard of it. I have not. I'm not a technology expert. He managed to sell Blastar to a computer magazine for $500 US. This boy was able to overcome the Goliaths in his life by pursuing his dreams. And you may have even heard of him. His name is Elon Musk, and he was the CEO of Tesla Motors and the founder of CEO of SpaceX. He is one of the richest men in the world right now, and definitely not bullied. In today's scripture lesson, we heard about a shepherd boy named who overcomes a giant by the name of Goliath and went on to become the king of Israel. Now, just a sidebar here, or over the last few weeks, we've had a couple sermons in this Samuel book, and we've learned that these people of Israel wanted a king. They wanted what they wanted. And one of their expectations was that this king would protect them from their enemies, right? Do you remember that? So that's where the mindset of the Israel people is, okay? And they wanted protection, particularly from the Philistines. So the Philistines used their great warrior Goliath to threaten Israel. So what does King Saul do? He goes out and he says, we need to fight the Goliath. But he doesn't do it, does he? He sends out the only volunteer. There's only one volunteer. The whole people of Israel, and there's one volunteer, folks. He sends one volunteer. Gets, which is a shepherd boy. And he sends this shepherd boy named David. And he sends him out without any skills to defeat this giant. The only skill David has is he has a slingshot, which is really, if you look at the picture on the front of your bulletin to the right, it's not your traditional slingshot to the left on your bulletin. It's a traditional slingshot on the right of your bulletin. And I could swear I have one, but I couldn't find it. But it's a long string with like a little, hammock almost. And it's only about this big. And they take it, they put the rock, and they swing it around and around and around till the till they do it a certain way and the rock flies off, right? That's all he's got. He has a slingshot, but what he has more of is trust in the Lord. He knows the Lord has saved them in the past. He trusts in the living God. It says it over and over in Scripture, right? So Saul agrees to send him out, and he offers him armor. You know, it's like a kid when they dress up in your clothes in the closet, right? Do you picture it? Right? So he tries to put the armor on, but it's too big and it's too heavy, and David can't even walk. So he takes it all off, and he only uses the resources of which he has. He uses his staff, he uses a sling, he uses some stones, and he uses the name of the Lord. And he hits this giant Goliath on the head and takes him down. We learn some important lessons from David. First, we cannot wear someone else's armor, my friend, when confronting the giants of our lives. We cannot hide behind someone else's armor. We need to lean on God and use the God-given gifts that we've been given. We need to trust in the strength and the power of God, not in the power of the bullies. Second, we can't allow the Goliaths of our lives or our lives' bullies to influence our behavior and hold power over us. We must go back to our roots of faith. So this whole scripture opens with this image of Goliath, right? So let's talk about this power. Goliath is this biblical character who his size, his armor, his personality leap out of the scripture. It's written in a way that yells that he is a power to be reckoned with, that he is scary. He is an impressive guy, right? He's big, he's powerful, his voice is booming, he has words that are bullish words, he's set in armor that is just intimidating. He's a threat. Everything about him speaks of a major danger. The scripture, the reason I read all 51 verses is because it builds momentum as it outlines the exact detail of his armor, all the way down to the weight of it on his head, on his spear. Power oozes from him. And then it goes on to tell us that for every morning, for 40 days, a wonderful biblical number, 40 days, right? Goliath repeatedly comes out and bullies the Israelites. And they cower. All this bluster promotes the Israelites to forget their faith. His size, his intimidation gives them spiritual amnesia, folks. They are paralyzed by their fear, and they seem to have no recollection of what God can do on their behalf, what God has done in the past. They do not seem to recall the freedom from Pharaoh, the parting of the Red Sea, the manna. They forget it all. Just as scripture spares no expense in giving us the detail of the dimensions of his stature and armor, it goes to great lengths to describe Israel's despair. So we've got this seasoned warrior and this shepherd boy. And now, David comes at this taunting Goliath with words. First, the Philistine Goliath says to David, "Come to me, and I'll give your flesh to the birds of the air and the wild beasts of the field." But David is not intimidated. He is the only Israelite was a story on social media, and I tried to print it, couldn't do it, so I'm going to try it on my phone here. Let's see if I can tell it to you. It was a story applauding an airline counter representative. Okay, so just put yourself in the airport now. Now you got to flip your imagery here. So in the airport, as is happening lately, the flights got shifted around, and the one flight got canceled. And so this airline customer service person is standing at the counter, and there's a whole lot of irritated customers, right? You might have even been there before, right? And there's nothing she can do but try to help you find another flight, right? She's got this whole line in front of her, and she's helping them. And suddenly, a man comes up and slams down his ticket. You may have read this on social media. Slams down his ticket and says, I need a flight right now, and I need first class. Without hesitating, she smiles. And she says, I'm sorry, sir, I would love to help you. But you need to go to the end of the line so I can help all these others who have been waiting. And that just makes it matter, right? And so then he says, do you know who I am? At which time, she picks up the microphone and she says without hesitating, may I have your attention? We have a passenger here at 8:14 who does not know who he is. If anyone can help him find his identity, please come to gate 14. People are laughing in line now, and he's getting more irritated. He uses words that I will not say. And she says, very calmly, sir, you're going to have to get in line for that, too. We chuckle at that. But, right, we live in a world of words. We live in a world right now that has a lot of Goliaths, right? There's challenges that are coming up against us, folks. Many of them words. Social media can be a David or a Goliath. COVID can be a David or a Goliath. It's a giant in front of us, but we can tackle it with faith and faithful words. The decline in churches because of COVID and because of the culture that was happening long before COVID is having us huddle in fear. And folks, we need to be David. We need to stand out there and say and hold on to our faith and use our words and our witness in faithful ways. I'm saying that to the choir here, but hurricanes will be attacking our neighbors in Louisiana today. We need to use our words and our faith to tackle the giants of weather, of illness, of struggles, of poverty. We need not condemn one another for who we are. We need to figure out how we're going to stand faithfully in front of the giant and tackle him with the faith that we have. Friends, Davids are who we are called to be. Goliaths are who we are called to stand up against. The power can go good or bad. Words can be strong or hurtful. We have to choose what they're going to be for us. And we have to ask ourselves, we need to reflect. So my friends, as you can see, I have lost my place. I don't know where I am in my notes, but what I will tell you is that there are a basket of stones or an offering plate of stones at both doors. And had I been really good, I would have used the advice of a colleague who shared this with me. She had little bags of 5 stones for you. I didn't have that, but you can get 5 stones. And in your bulletin, I have a time of reflection. And this week, I want to invite you to think about the powers you have and the powers that are standing against you. The powers that are standing in this world and the powers that faithful people have in the name of God. A living God that is living in and through and amongst ourselves. And I want you to think about what is your witness of power today? How will you use your power today and in the days to come? What armor are you prone to wear? In what ways are you tempted, in other words, to look and put on what the world will have you put on? What does it mean for you to be a shepherd kid and not a Goliath? And how do you use your power to point trust in a living God? Amen. Friends, I want to invite us to just take a moment to gather in our thoughts. And if you have a stone in your hand, great. If not, that's okay. Just take a moment in the silence before I start our prayer time communally to think about the power that you have and the way you can use that power to point to God. God, there are days when it seems like we are surrounded by giants too large to slay. We feel helpless against the foes in our own lives and those at large in the world. We remember those on our prayer list who are struggling with giants that cause them to suffer in mind, body, and spirit. We are wrestling with natural giants, wildfires, hurricanes. We're struggling, faced with the ongoing giant of COVID. We are struggling with the giants of words spoken and shared on social media and other means that are harmful and hurtful to our brothers and sisters, God's children. We are struggling with the reality that people are making choices that don't include faith and faith communities. And yet, you give us the strength. You give us the power when we trust in you to move forward with words of forgiveness and kindness and loving. Words that unite us rather than tear us down. So, Lord, in this time of worship and prayer, we invite your Spirit that is always with us to give us the strength and the core to be David in the world today. Give us the slingshot that will eliminate fears and broken relationships and suffering and grief. feels gigantic in our lives. Because we yearn to be whole. We long to be at peace with one another and all in this world. As we wrestle, help us remember these struggles are temporary. Remind us that you are our stronghold in times of trouble. Remind us that we can rely on you. We need not fear. Instill in us a strong faith. Fill us with your Spirit. Inspire us and guide us in ways to help spread your loving presence, to overcome the giants, and to help us reconcile with you in peace. We ask this in your name as we say together,